Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship in God's house on this glorious beginning of Holy Week. Palm Sunday for centuries has been celebrated the sixth Sunday in Lent, but about the time of the Reformation, churches began to celebrate Passion Sunday or Sunday of the Passion, and that's what we'll be celebrating today as well as Palm Sunday. You know, that first Palm Sunday, there were people gathered for a festival, and of course, children and songs and praising going on as the King of Kings rode into his own city. But he didn't come to create some type of fight or a battle scene. He came to surrender to his Heavenly Father's will in fulfillment of prophecy to be the Savior. And so we welcome our coming King once again. If you have a binder, and I encourage you to open it, you can see there's introductory reading about Palm Passion Sunday that's going on, page 9. And then we'll begin our worship if you turn to page 10. With that in mind, Let us glorify our God as we welcome our King and we sing his praises. Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Dear friends in Christ, during the weeks of Lent, we have been preparing to commemorate our Lord's suffering, death, and resurrection. Today, we come together to begin the solemn journey of Holy Week. Christ entered in triumph into his own city to complete his work as our Savior, and to gain for us the forgiveness of sins, life, and salvation. We follow him in faith and praise him with joy. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Please be seated. In the name of the one who comes in humility, lowliness, bringing righteousness and salvation. Our reading for today, Philippians chapter 2. Paul writes, though he was by nature God, he did not consider equality with God as a prize to be displayed, but he emptied himself by taking the nature of a servant. When he was born in human likeness, and his appearance was like that of any other man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord. Friends in Christ, the road that stretches from the Mount of Olives to the gates of Jerusalem is now called Palm Sunday Road. Thousands and thousands of pilgrims will go through the streets of Jerusalem this very week. And Jesus' triumphal entry to his own city is commemorated as people wave their palms and shout and sing, "Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord," giving all glory, laud, and honor to our Redeemer King. But the way of the cross, the road to the cross, the Via Dolorosa, the way of sorrows, is by far the more famous of the roads in the Holy Land. I remember in 2011, I got to walk that road. Those were the very steps our Savior took on the way to the cross. And while no one knows exactly where the path began, you see, the city of Jerusalem was destroyed in 70 AD, and so there were walls that were put in various places after the fact that I remember walking and saying, "Where does the road continue?" And there was a wall right in front of me. Oh, we have to go around this to go on the road again. The road to the cross, very moving. And yet, the most important thing that we can think about isn't any earthly city or any earthly road. It is the way our Savior, he willingly took that road. He knew what he was doing, and the path began not on the Mount of Olives, not even in the city of Jerusalem outside the Praetorium. The path began in the throne room of heaven, the very beginning, when Jesus, he said yes, yes to the Father. And Paul writes about how, though he was in nature God, equal to the Father in every way, glorified with the Spirit in every way, he did not consider equality with God something to hold on to or to hold up like a trophy. What did he do? He emptied himself, and he took the nature of a servant when he was born in human likeness. We've been journeying with Jesus for about 3 months now. We've seen from Bethlehem's manger through the Epiphany season, from the Jordan River to the Mountain of Transfiguration, and all these weeks of Lent, we've seen how Jesus chose that path, and he became obedient. Why? So many of his disciples tried to deter him. "Don't do this, Lord. Don't go to Jerusalem." Judas was plotting already to show what he thought of Jesus by betraying him for money. The chief priests, the so-called elders of the people, they wanted to put him on trial and put him to death to make a mockery of him. And what about you? What about me? By nature, none of us have true fear of our King, true love for God. None of us thinks of anyone but ourselves and how we want to be in charge. We want to rule. We're the ones with the pride. But our Savior rides. He rides in humility. He rides lowly. He comes, and nothing's going to stop him from his passion. The word passion means suffering. Why is it so important for us to hear the words of the Passion reading year after year? It's not just that Jesus suffered. Everyone suffers. He suffered willingly. He chose this. He wanted to, because he knew the only path to heaven was if he came as our substitute and is the Savior who lays down his life, his perfect life, only to take it up again. Oh, Jesus, King of glory. Oh, Jesus, who humbly came and loved us, all praise and thanks be to you. You've saved us from hell. You've taken on yourself the sins of the whole world. Your love for your enemies is so awesome and majestic. Only you could do this, Lord Jesus. And for that, we want to give you not just our lip service or a waving of palms. We want to worship. We want to worship here in your house, Lord. We want to worship in our own homes. We want to worship you each day of this holy week in thankfulness for all you've done. How will you honor your King this holy week? May it be with true praise. May it be with pondering. May you come on Maundy, Thursday, see his precious supper given on the very night he was betrayed. Come Good Friday, see at the cross the payment for all your sins and the freedom from guilt and condemnation that you receive. And come on Easter, celebrate with the triumph of the Lord's resurrection, which is our resurrection. My dear friends, let every knee bow in humility and every tongue confess to the glory of God that Jesus Christ is the Lord and the King of Kings. Amen. At this time, we'll listen as the welcoming song is sung, Lift the Palms, by our grade school.
Thank you. We can clap for that one. We continue with the passion history of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, according to the Holy Gospel of St. Mark. You can follow along if you wish on the inside pages of your worship booklet. It was 2 days before the Passover and the festival of unleavened bread. The chief priests and the experts in the law were looking for some deceptive way to arrest Jesus and kill him. Certainly not during the festival, they said, or there will be a riot among the people. While Jesus was in Bethany, in the house of Simon the leper, as he was reclining at the table, a woman came with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume made of pure nard. She broke the alabaster jar and poured it over his head. But there were some who were indignant and said to one another, "Why has this perfume been wasted? Certainly this perfume could have been sold for more than 300 denarii and given to the poor." And they began to scold her. But Jesus said, "Leave her alone. Why are you bothering her? She has done a beautiful thing for me. In fact, you always will have the poor with you, and whenever you want, you can do good for them. But you are not always going to have me." She did what she could. She anointed my body beforehand for burial. Amen, I tell you. Wherever the gospel is preached in the whole world, what this woman did will also be told in memory of her. Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went to the chief priests in order to betray Jesus to them. When they heard this, they were glad and promised to give him money, so he began to look for an opportunity to betray Jesus. On the first day of the festival of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, his disciples asked him, "Where do you want us to go and prepare for you to eat the Passover?" He sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the city, and there a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. Wherever he enters, tell the owner of the house that the teacher says, 'Where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large upper room, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there." His disciples left and went into the city and found things just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he arrived with the 12. While they were reclining and eating, Jesus said, "Amen, I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." They began to be sorrowful and said to him one by one, "Surely not I." He said to them, "It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread with me in the dish. Indeed, the Son of Man is going to go just as it has been written about him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that man if he had not been born." We continue with hymn 409.
While they were eating, Jesus took bread. When he had blessed it, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take it. This is my body." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them. They all drank from it. He said to them, "This is my blood of the New Testament, which is poured out for many. Amen, I tell you, I will certainly not drink again of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." After they sang a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Jesus said to them, "You will all fall away because of me, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I am raised, I will go ahead of you into Galilee." But Peter said to him, "Even if all fall away, I will not." Jesus said to him, "Amen, I tell you, today, this very night, before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times." But Peter kept saying emphatically, "Even if I have to die with you, I will never deny you." And they all said the same. They went to a place named Gethsemane. Jesus told his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." Then he took Peter, James, and John along with him and began to be troubled and distressed. He said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow, even to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch." Going forward a little, he fell on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He also said, "Abba, Father, everything is possible for you. Take this cup away from me. Yet not what I will, but what you will." When he returned to the disciples, he found them sleeping. He said to Peter, "Simon, are you sleeping? Were you not strong enough to keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." Again, he went away and prayed, saying the same thing. When he returned, he found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. They did not know what they should answer him. He returned the third time and said to them, "Are you going to continue sleeping and resting? It is enough. The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Look, my betrayer is near." We'll continue by singing hymn 425.
Just then, while he was speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. The crowd was with him, armed with swords and clubs. They were from the chief priests, the experts in the law, and the elders. Now his betrayer had given them a signal, saying, "The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard." He went right to Jesus and said, "Rabbi," and kissed him. They laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood nearby drew his sword, struck the servant of the high priest, and cut off his ear. Jesus responded by saying to them, "Have you come out with swords and clubs to capture me as you would a criminal? Day after day I was with you, teaching in the temple courts, and you did not arrest me. But this happened so that the scriptures may be fulfilled. Then the disciples all left him and fled. A certain young man was following him, wearing just a linen cloth over his naked body. They seized him, but he left behind the linen cloth and fled from them naked. They led Jesus away to the high priest. All the chief priests, the elders, and the experts in the law gathered together. Peter followed him at a distance right into the courtyard of the high priest. He was sitting with the guards and warming himself at the fire. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death, but they did not find any. Many testified falsely against him, but their testimonies did not agree. Some stood up and gave this false testimony against him. We heard him say, I will destroy this temple made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another made without hands. Yet even on this point, their testimony did not agree. The high priest stepped forward and questioned Jesus. Have you no answer? What is this they are testifying against you? But Jesus was silent and did not answer anything. Again, the high priest asked him, Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One? I am, Jesus said. And you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of power and coming with the clouds of heaven. The high priest tore his robes and said, Why do we need any more witnesses? You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think? They all condemned him as being worthy of death. Then some began to spit on him. They covered his face and struck him with their fists, saying, Prophesy! The guards also took him and beat him. We continue with hymn 432.
While Peter was in the courtyard below, one of the servant girls of the high priest came there. When she saw Peter warming himself, she looked directly at him and said, You were also with the Nazarene Jesus. But he denied it, saying, I don't know or understand what you are saying. And he went out to the entryway. Then a rooster crowed. When the servant girl saw him, once more she began to tell those standing there, This is one of them. But again, he denied it. After a little while, those who were standing there said to Peter, Surely you are one of them, because you are a Galilean. But he began to curse and to swear, I do not know this man you are talking about. Just then, the rooster crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered what Jesus had said to him, Before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me 3 times. And he broke down and wept. As soon as it was morning, the chief priests, along with the elders, the experts in the law, and the whole Sanhedrin reached a decision. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" He answered him, "It is as you say." The chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate questioned him again, "Are you not going to answer anything? See how many charges they are bringing against you?" But Jesus still did not answer anything. So Pilate was amazed. At each festival, Pilate used to release to the people one prisoner whom they requested. There was one named Barabbas, who was imprisoned with the rebels and had committed murder in the rebellion. The crowd came up and began to ask Pilate to do for them what he usually did. Pilate replied, "Do you want me to release the king of the Jews to you?" In fact, he knew that it was because of envy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas to them instead. Again, Pilate replied to them, "Then what do you want me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?" "Crucify him," they shouted back. But Pilate said to them, "Why? What has he done wrong?" But they shouted even louder, "Crucify him!" Since he wanted to satisfy the crowd, Pilate released Barabbas to them. After he had Jesus flogged, he handed him over to be crucified. We sing hymn 397.
The soldiers led him away inside the palace, which is the praetorium, and called together the whole cohort of soldiers. They put a purple robe on him, twisted together a crown of thorns, and put it on him. The soldiers began to salute him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They kept hitting him on the head with a reed and spitting on him. They also kneeled down to pay homage to him. When they had mocked him, they took off the purple robe and put on his own clothing on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. A certain man, Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus, was passing by on his way in from the country. They forced him to carry Jesus' cross. They brought Jesus to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of a skull. They tried to give him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. They crucified him. And they divided his garments, casting lots for them to decide what each of them would take. Now it was the third hour when they crucified him. The superscription stating the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." They also crucified two criminals with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by ridiculed him, shaking their heads and saying, "Ha, you who are going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests, along with the experts in the law, mocked him among themselves. "He saved others," they said, He cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross so that we may see and believe. We continue with hymn 434.
When it was the sixth hour, darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour. At the ninth hour, Jesus shouted with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing there heard this, they said, "Listen, he's calling Elijah." When someone ran and filled a sponge with sour wine and put it on a stick and gave it to him to drink, they said, "Leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to take him down." Jesus cried out with a loud voice and breathed his last. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. When the centurion who stood facing him saw how he cried out and breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this man was the Son of God." There were also women watching from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James the Younger, and of Joses, and Salome. While he was in Galilee, they followed him and served him. Many other women also came up with him to Jerusalem. It was already evening, and since it was preparation day, that is the day before the Sabbath, Joseph from Arimathea, a prominent member of the council who was himself waiting for the kingdom of God, boldly went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate was surprised that he was already dead. He summoned the centurion and asked him if Jesus had been dead for a long time. When he learned from the centurion that it was so, he granted the body to Joseph. Joseph bought a linen cloth, took him down, and wrapped him in the linen cloth. He laid him in a tomb that had been cut out of a rock, and he rolled a stone against the entrance of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joses, were watching where the body was laid. Thus ends the Passion reading. We'll continue with hymn 437.
Yeah.
having heard the wondrous story of God's love for you, we respond with our grateful offerings. If you brought an offering, you can make use of the offering plates or use our online giving option. We worship the Lord this Holy Week, and we invite many others to come and worship our Savior King with us. As announcements are made on the radio and the broadcast over the internet, I encourage you to sign our friendship register and pass it on down to others in your row while we listen to some beautiful music and ponder our Savior's love.
You are listening to the worship service of St. Peter's Lutheran Church in Sturgeon Bay. St. Peter's is affiliated with the Wisconsin Evangelical Lutheran Synod, or WELS. The WELS is a worldwide church with congregations serving all 50 states and Canada, and also serves over 25 foreign countries through world missions. We thank you for joining us in our worship today. If you would like to contribute to St. Peter's ministry, you are welcome to mail your offerings to the church at 108 West Maple Street, Sturgeon Bay, Wisconsin, 54235. Or make a donation online at stpeterslutheran.net. Thank you for supporting our ministry to share Christ. God's blessings to you today and always from St. Peter's Lutheran Church in Sturgeon Bay, Wisconsin.
Please stand for prayer. Lord Jesus, you are the King of heaven and earth. We join the First Palm Sunday worshipers in praising and glorifying you for coming to this earth to be our Savior. Though you are one with God the Father and Lord of all, you humbled yourself and became one with us. Thanks be to you for living a life of perfect conformity to God's holy law in our place. Praise be to you for being obedient to death, even death on a cross, to redeem us from sin. Cause our voices to blend with those who sang your praises as you rode into Jerusalem. Move us to confess you before others as our Lord. Help us proclaim the message of peace and forgiveness to people of all nations. Use us to assure all people that your blood has cleansed them from sin and set them free from slavery to sin, death, and the devil. Move us to dedicate all we are and have to your glory. We thank you, Lord, for the many years of life you so graciously granted to Jim Larson, who turns 80 years old on Monday. Through the years, in good days and bad, you have been his comfort and strength. You've been his guide through times of joy and sorrow, sickness and in health. And you've provided Jim with the comfort of your word and sacraments. Cause Jim and his family to daily remember your kindness so that they may give thanks for all your blessings. And continue to be his strength until that day when he stands in peace before your throne of grace. We also thank you, Lord, that in our nation we have the freedom of religion, the privilege to worship you without fear. Many in our world do not have this liberty. Move the hearts of Christians to worship you all the more this Holy Week. Bless our upcoming elections held on April 2nd. Move us to vote for leaders who will govern with wisdom, honesty, courage, and justice. Give us willingness to obey our nation's laws and work for the common good of citizens. Strengthen the homes of our nation and teach us in all things to humbly depend on you as the only true King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We also give you thanks, Lord, for calling home the soul early this morning of Janine Herzog, Pat's mom and Ben's grandma. Thank you, Lord, for bringing her home to heaven, and it will be yet another reason to sing in praise and triumph on Easter this year. Thank you, Lord, for bringing her home after 95 years of her life here, and now she gets to live with you forever in heaven. Comfort the family of the Herzogs, Jesus. And dear Savior, as we walk this week with you toward Calvary, keep us focused on your purpose for coming into this world and on our calling to spread this wonderful message of salvation. Hear us for your mercy's sake. Amen. As we join to pray the prayer our Savior's taught us, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated. We'll join in the closing hymn, No Tramp of Marching Feet, of Soldiers Marching Feet. King of Glory comes. Good morning.
Good morning.
Special welcome to our guests who are here with us today. We are very pleased to have you, and we invite you to worship with us all week and anytime you're available for an opportunity to praise our God with us. You know, we have Holy Week announcements in this small insert. I would encourage you all to take these and then bring them back for worship on Monday, Thursday. You'll notice that the next page has devotional resources for Holy Week, special readings for each day and morning and evening. So a great resource. And as long as you bring them back, go ahead and take them home. Use them. Like I said, not only worship God in his house, but worship him in your homes too this special week. As we look forward to spring break starting this Friday for the students of St. Peter's, we thank them for singing today. We thank Leah, we thank Joe, and we thank Emily for all those beautiful hymns that you have. We have an opportunity to have a voters meeting right after we dismiss and go visit the Faithful Hands tables. The voters meeting has the agenda item of calling a 7th and 8th grade teacher. And if there are other items adopted to the agenda, we'll take a look at some of those as well. I want to encourage you to look at the Faithful Hands bazaar, if you will. It's not as bizarre as you think it is. It's actually quite awesome. There are some delicious foods. If you miss Pie Day on 314, there's Pie Day today. You can go get some pie. You can get some wonderful decorations and crafts. Special thanks to Jim Peterson for those beautiful stars made out of the church pews with the crosses on them. Awesome. So lots to think about this special week, but no more important thought than this, that your Savior King came willingly and suffered for you so that you do not have to have eternal death in hell. What a Savior. May God bless us all as we worship Him this week. Children, if you'd like to, you can come up and get a palm again. You don't have to go all the way to the Holy Land to get one. You can go ahead and get one here today. So may God richly bless you in your walk to Calvary this week. Good morning.